Good morning, Lord Grimstone, Minister for Investment, the United Kingdom. Mrs. Ruchi Ghansham, former Indian High Commissioner to the United Kingdom. Chandrajit Banerjee, Director General of the Confederation of Indian Industries. Lords Billamoria, Gadia, Moore and Poppet, and Baroness Usha Prasha. And ladies and gentlemen joining from India and the United Kingdom. My name is Anuj Chande, corporate finance partner and founder head of the South Asia Group, which has been in existence for nearly three decades. Welcome to the 2020 Grant Thornton India Meets Britain report, produced in collaboration with the Confederation of Indian Industries. This is actually the seventh edition of the report, and we recognize that we are launching this report under the shadow of the COVID-19 global pandemic. We also recognize that Indian-owned companies in the UK, very much like their peer companies, are facing some very challenging times and are likely to do so for the future. Having said that, together with our collaborators, the CII, Grant Thornton felt it was important to recognize the economic importance of Indian companies in the UK, particularly as we all come out of the recovery of the COVID-19 crisis. It gives us great pleasure that we have a number of keynote speakers present here this morning and this afternoon. And without further ado, I would request Mrs. Ruchi Ghansham, please, to come on screen. Mrs. Ghansham, until last week, was the former High Commissioner of India to the United Kingdom. And in her short tenure as High Commissioner, she has made a tremendous impact on India-UK relationships, and particularly with the Indian diaspora in the UK. At Grant Thornton, we're particularly appreciative of Mrs. Ghansham's initiatives, as she was the one that initiated the Indian diaspora report, which we launched earlier this year. Mrs. Ghansham, could you perhaps give us the Indian perspective of the economic contribution of Indian companies to the United Kingdom?
Good morning to everyone. Lord Grimstone, the Minister for Investment of UK, Anu Chande, Mr. Chandrajit Banerjee, Director General of CII, Lords, ladies and gentlemen, and all the eminent business people present here today. I feel extremely privileged to have this opportunity to launch the Grant Thornton CII India Meets Britain Tracker 2020 report. Even though I have retired on 30th of April, but it's a mark of the circumstances that I'm joining this meeting from London and not from Delhi. And the same circumstances, we have to do this online rather than in a grand event like we did earlier in the year for the report of the diaspora effect in UK, the diaspora effect, Indian diaspora effect report that was launched in February 2020 at the Guildhall. India and UK have stood together for a very long time, and we continue to work together in multiple fields. And I think this report that is being launched today only serves to highlight that point once again. Even during this very unprecedented situation and times that we are in, we find that many areas of collaboration are being explored. And from the UK side, as well as from the Indian side, people are trying to work together. And this is a very important hallmark of this relationship between our two countries. I was very privileged also to launch the report last year. And the figures at that time were very impressive as well. I think they have perhaps improved themselves in some areas. $48 billion of pounds of investment by Indian companies in the UK, with £685 million in corporation tax and 105,000 jobs. A very impressive contribution by Indian companies to UK's economy indeed. It was even a bigger moment of pride for me earlier in the year when we were able to have at least the first assessment or estimate of the contribution of companies that have been set up by the Indian diaspora in the UK. As the Grant Thornton Fickey report showed at that time, that there are 65,000 businesses in UK owned by the Indian diaspora. Of them, only 650 companies with £100,000 turnover were reported to have a total turnover of more than £36 billion, generating over 175,000 jobs. Combined together, the Indian companies in UK and the companies owned by the Indian diaspora make a total investment of about £85 billion, pay over £1.7 billion in tax, and employ almost 280,000 people. Together, I think the Indian companies and the diaspora companies are making a very major contribution to this very important bilateral relationship. I am very eager, like everyone else, to hear from Mr. Chandy the figures for this year's report and to see how these figures compare with previous years. The possibilities at the moment are looking very challenging, but in these challenging times, it is for companies to work together and see how the economic impact of this crisis can be mitigated. This is a time where companies have to try and find solutions and find ways to work in these challenging circumstances as we are doing today. Government of UK has announced a number of supportive measures. The Indian companies in UK are facing also several challenges in their operations here, like everyone else. I hope that their challenges will also be heard by the government, and that they would find a very supportive environment to continue working in the UK. At the High Commission, during the month of April, when I was High Commissioner, we tried to find ways of reaching out to Indian companies in UK and to hear their challenges, as well as we tried to reach out to the UK companies in India. And these brought up some issues. I hope that today's discussion will again provide an opportunity for Indian companies to put across their ideas on how they can continue to succeed in the current challenging environment. At the end, let me thank Grant Thornton and CII for coming out with this very important document, and this being the ninth in the most unusual circumstances. But the fact that the circumstances have not deterred either the CII or GT speaks of the great degree of optimism with which we can look towards the future. I hope that this report continues to come out successfully and bring out these facts again and again every year. Once again, I thank you all for joining this event today, and I wish everyone very good health and well-being in these difficult times. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Ghanshyam, for those very encouraging words, and obviously also putting into context the India Meets Britain report in the context of the Indian diaspora contribution as well. Our next keynote speaker is Lord Grimstone. Lord Grimstone is actually a recently appointed Minister for Investment. He is no stranger to India-UK relationships. I recall actually being on the South Asia Advisory Group Board for Citi UK, where he was also a board member. And I know that more recently, in recent times, he's been UK co-chair of the UK-India CEO Forum. Lord Grimstone, we're delighted to have you with us for this launch, and we would very much like to hear from you in terms of the UK government perspective of the economic contribution by Indian companies. Lord Grimstone, please come on screen. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Anuj. Thank you for that welcome, and good morning, good afternoon, High Commissioner, lords and ladies, and the various people on this call. I'm delighted to be with you this morning, because perhaps as you've just heard, India has a very special place in my heart. I've been closely associated with India for the last 15 years. I helped create HDFC Life and HDFC Asset Management with my great friend Deepak Parekh, As you've just heard, I co-chaired the UK-India CEO Forum with my great friend Ajay Piramal, and I'm also co-chair of the UK-India Financial Partnership with my good friend Uday Kotak. So in a sense, India now has a minister who has a close affinity with India at the very heart of the Indian, of the UK government. And I'm very pleased to be able to say that. I have an important role in the government. I'm a minister both in the International Trade Department and in the Business Department. And my responsibilities, I am responsible for all inward investment into the United Kingdom, whether that's foreign direct investment, whether it's portfolio investment, or whether it's fund investment. I feel I provide a concierge service for those Indian companies that are in the UK. And if any company wishes to contact myself, my office, if there's things I can help unblock. So I, of course, want Indian companies to feel welcome here. And another part of my responsibilities is to make sure that companies which are based here, whatever nationality, we help them export overseas and we help them further internationalize their business. I'm also the government spokesman on trade policy in the House of Lords. So I'm very involved in free trade agreements. We launched the UK-US free trade agreement just 2 days ago. And I'm looking forward to the time when I'm able to finally launch a UK-India free trade agreement. I thought the work that GT and CII have done on this for this forum is amazing, because without tracking information such as this, we cannot see how well we are doing. And of course, we are doing very well. The data clearly shows the continued strength of the UK-India relationship, the importance of India as one of our most critical bilateral investors and job creators, with over 110,000 jobs attributable to investors listed in this report. And critically, those jobs are all over the United Kingdom. It's a great record, but I have to say to everybody on this call, we can and we should be doing more. Given the remarkable close affinities between the UK and India, given the success that our companies have when they operate in each other's countries, I know we can do more. And part of my role going forward is working with my friends in India, CII and others, to see how we can make a reality of that. I should have started this call, of course, by saying, important though these matters are, the most important matter during this dreadful crisis is to keep ourselves safe, our families and friends safe, and our colleagues safe. We know that the UK is a key market for India, but I would like to draw particular attention at this moment to the enormous help that the United Kingdom has had from India during the crisis. And of course, as the provider of more than half the world's vaccines and the single largest producer of generic drugs, India has a vital role to play in the containment of COVID-19 around the world. And I think this is an opportunity for India, as it so often has done in the past, to show global leadership. In demonstrating its global leadership, it's important to all of us that India and other people's supply chains stay open. The world needs trade more than ever at this important time. And I would like to thank the government of India from my heart for its commitment to this, through in particular the removal of barriers that it has made to the export of paracetamol, which has saved lives in the United Kingdom. And I have to thank the Indian government from that. As everybody on this call knows, we have introduced a range of special measures in the United Kingdom to help firms. I hope they have benefited the firms on this call. We will continue to look at those schemes, and we will continue to do all we can and all that is necessary to help firms. We're living in a terrible time at the moment. The outcome of this crisis means, for the first time ever, we face the need for global recapitalization. We've had sector recapitalizations in the past, we've had regional recapitalizations, we've had company recapitalizations. We now face a global recapitalization, and all countries will need to pull together in order to achieve this. And I have no doubt that bilateral relationships between UK and India will play a major part in both our countries' economic growth going forward. So let's get trade properly up and running again. Let's get investment flowing. Every country will be looking at its global supply chains. It will be looking to diversify its supply chains. And let's hope that India and the United Kingdom are strong beneficiaries of that. So I've enjoyed these few minutes speaking to you today. I'm looking forward for when the crisis is over to come to India. It'll be one of the first places that I come to as a minister. And I look forward to a continued dialogue with the people on this call and all my other friends and counterparts in India. Thank you all very much. And I'll now hand back to Anuj. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lord Grimstone, for those very encouraging words and the challenges that you have given us in terms of trade and investment. I think you make a very pertinent point about global recapitalization. That's never happened before. And of course, that is the world's biggest challenge that we all face together. And thank you very much again for your time. I'd now like to introduce Chandrajit Banerjee, the Director General of the CII, to come on screen. CB, as we affectionately know him, is a good friend of Grant Thornton's, both in the UK and in India. And we are particularly delighted that we're working with CII now for the seventh year in this report, and the collaboration is going from strength to strength. I'd like CB now to give us the Indian industry perspective of Indian economic contribution to the United Kingdom. CB, over to you. Sorry, on mute, CB. No, still on mute. Should be a button at the top of the screen.
Ah, is that okay now?
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, that's clear, yeah.
Thanks. Thanks, Anuj, and good morning to all in London and those who have joined me from India. Warm, very good afternoon. And great to be connected virtually, really missing London. The first summer in ages that one would not be there, but hope to make up through these type of virtual links. And I also really hope that everybody is safe and well. So wonderful to be connected with our friends in London and our well-wishers and our partners. Let me first start according a very, very special thanks and a welcome and congratulations to Lord Jerry Grimstone, the Minister for Investment, for his new role. You are indeed very, very familiar, and as you said, with the CII and with India and the various activities that we have been involved in, and have bothered you thousands of times in your previous hat as the co-chair of the India-UK CEOs Forum. And it was great working with you and Ajay. As you mentioned, throughout the CEO's Forum's journey, it was fantastic work that we put together, and grateful that you have been able to join us here today. We look forward to working with you closely in the days ahead as a minister, and we really look forward, as you again said, for yours being in India very, very soon. Let me now turn to our former High Commissioner. In fact, one had to remember to use the word former, as this is so very recent, and Mrs. Ruchi Ghanshyam. So was very, very happy to see you and to also hear you through this platform. It has been a great journey under your leadership for the Indian businesses in UK, and also, of course, for CII. Your warmth, your leadership has always been there. Thank you, Mrs. Ghanshyam, for all the years in many, many roles, including that of a High Commissioner, throughout your great diplomatic career, and collective best wishes from all of us for all your future endeavors. I must say that whenever one speaks to an audience in London and in the UK, we have some very wonderful friends wonderful friends of mine, wonderful friends of Indian industry, of CII. And I must say, I'm missing their physical presence today. They have stood always by us for many, many years. They have given us many opportunities and has guided us strongly on every project that we have been in. Let me mention a few, as I understand, who are present here. Lord Billimoria, Lord Jitesh Gadia, Baroness Sandeep Verma, Baroness Usha Parashar, Lord Dolar Papat, Lord Lumba. Not sure if I've missed anyone because I'm not able to see many of you who are present, but a big thank you and my warmest greetings to all of you from Delhi. My special thanks to my partners and my very, very good friends, Anuj, Chandru, and the team at the Grand Thornton UK for hosting this web launch of this much sought after report. And I know how much this is sought after both in UK as well as in India. And great work as always put in by Grand Thornton. And we love this partnership and a strong partnership with my CII colleagues, especially with Lakshmi Kaul in bringing up this report up to you all today. This joint research project, as was mentioned by Anuj, clearly represents what I would say the figures to remind us that Indian industry shapes not only the growth story of India, but in difficult times. And also, Lord Jerry, you also mentioned this, in difficult times, proves to be a friend, any nation to rebuild its economy with patience, perseverance, and confidence. These are really unprecedented times for humanity. And as we navigate through the challenges, it is a useful reminder to note and underscore the valuable contribution of our Indian industry in the UK's economy, especially as we launch this India Meets Britain Tracker 2020, mapping the fastest growing Indian investments in the United Kingdom. I strongly believe that the Indian industry really needs to be viewed as a jobs creator, a wealth creator, as a nation builder, and also as global leaders from the Indian industry. And I have noticed in many of my interactions that the statistics published each year of this joint venture, of this report that we bring out between the Grand Thornton and India and CII, this gets quoted at many, many forums in both in UK, and I've seen this being quoted also in India. However, its real impact must be delivered at the grassroots levels with increased visibility via media and in parliamentary references on industry, especially in the context of shaping the new economic reality and the looming post-Brexit contours. As I saw through the findings of this report, I see that it really demonstrates the strength of our economic partnership, especially as we all navigate our way through these challenging times. I personally found the report to also represent the strong focus that the United Kingdom and India had on certain important sectors like the energy and infrastructure, sustainability, technology, and of course, healthcare. And one very important feature to be was that engineering and manufacturing, as also business services, though have seen a decline in the report, we know that this, with adaptation, there will be a surge in these sectors too in the forthcoming months and years. So CII really has a very strong commitment to work across the regions in the United Kingdom. And I'm pleased to note that we are beginning to see the footprints of Indian companies across in the regions. As champions of the UK-India trade and investment, the report findings indicate trends and also the mood of Indian investments in the United Kingdom. I'd really like to take this opportunity and also congratulate all the winners here today and paying a really glowing tribute to the Indian industry in the United Kingdom for their immense contribution to shaping the growth story of a great nation. I must say that in turbulent times like these, Indian industry has demonstrated its grit, strength via its adaptability and its resilience. It makes me also quite happy and proud to be joining all of you via this platform, having honored your achievement and noting your continued success, and more importantly, your contribution in the UK. I'd like to conclude by saying that this year, the year 2020, marks the 125 years and CII of CII's existence. CII has, since its beginning, 125 years ago, we have a very strong British connect, and over the last few decades, really cemented strongly the foundation of the partnership of Britain with Britain. Its government, its industry, its policymakers, its institutions, and its people. We will continue to grow on this. And in fact, I must, I mentioned this last year at the launch of this platform, and I repeat that 125 years ago, CII was formed in Calcutta by five British companies present in India in 1895. And therefore, the bond is but natural. I'm particularly grateful to my colleagues at the Indian industry and our key stakeholders across regions, our MOU partners in the UK, our friends at the Grand Thornton, and most specially, the High Commission of India, and of course, the UK government in this very, very fantastic journey that we have had. Stay safe, stay well. Thank you again, Anuj.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, CB. If you could just stay on screen. Thank you very much for those very encouraging and motivating words. And we are, as I repeat again, we are particularly pleased to be collaborating with you, especially in your 125th year. And congratulations from Grant Thornton for that. And it was particularly interesting to see that five British companies were set up the Confederation in Calcutta. So that's very appropriate that we have a UK minister here, and we have yourself representing India, and the former Indian High Commissioner there representing that collaboration, which is clearly a long-standing collaboration. If I could ask Lord Grimstone and Mrs. Ghanshyam, please, to switch on their cameras, we can now formally launch the 2020 Grant Thornton India Meets Britain report. Thank you very much for doing that. So now that you're all on screen, we can virtually launch the Grant Thornton 2020 Grant Thornton India Meets Britain report, produced in collaboration with CII. The report is now officially launched. Thank you very much. So before I actually give you the highlights of this year's reports, some of which you've already heard from the previous speakers, I think we need to put this year's report in context, which clearly we all are all aware of. But we also need to put it into the context of what's happened in the last year in both countries. In the United Kingdom, you had almost parliamentary paralysis with all the Brexit discussions and the ongoing discussions, which then culminated in the UK elections with the majority victory for the Conservative government. In India, you had faltering economic growth down to about 4.5%. You had the Indian government also facing some political issues in certain states. And of course, you had the continuing need to continue the economic reforms in India. So it's again, it's in that context that we need to look at the results of this report. And as you'll see in a few moments, it's extremely encouraging that within the context of those challenging times for both countries, Indian investment continued to be robust. So let me just give you some of the key highlights for this report. As I say, the copies of this report will be available online through a link which will come to all participants post this seminar. So this year's report, the 2020 report, identified that there were 842 companies in the UK. For those of you who are keen followers of figures, you will notice that's exactly the same number as we had in last year's report. That doesn't mean that there's been no change at all in the number of companies, far, far from it. We actually had 68 new Indian companies come into the United Kingdom, but that was equally matched by 68 Indian companies that went through, either got sold or were restructured in some way or the other. On a combined basis, they contributed £41.2 billion and they paid taxes of £462 million. And employment-wise, they employed just under 111,000 people. Again, for those of you who are keen on figures, you'll notice that there's been a decline in revenue, combined revenue and tax. And that's again in the main accounted for by one large Indian company that has not yet filed its accounts. Another important statistic that I'd just like to highlight to you is that on the diversity side, 20% of Indian companies in the UK have at least one woman on the board. This compares very favorably to the Nifty 500 in India, where it is 15%. And we look forward to continuing that trend in years to come. One of the things that we do in this India Meets Repetition report is that we track the fastest growing companies in the UK, Indian companies in the UK. In order to be in the fast track, the company has to have a minimum turnover of 5 million in both years, and it has to have grown by more than 10%, which I think is an achievement in itself. This year, we actually had 72 companies join the tracker. Last year, it was 62, so there's been an increase of 10. On a combined basis, they have generated 3.8 billion of turnover. And a figure which I really, really want to congratulate the businesses on who are on the tracker is that on average, they achieved 40% growth, which I think is absolutely phenomenal in any context. If you didn't take out the outliers, actually that growth rate would be 49%. The fastest growing company there has got a growth rate of 715%. It's absolutely outstanding. In terms of the size of these companies that are in the tracker, just under half would be turning over between 5 to 25 million. Another just under half would be turning 25 to 250 million pounds. And the remainder, which is just under 4%, would be turning over more than 250 million pounds. If we now turn to the sectors that these Indian companies operate in, and CB did mention that in his talk earlier, technology and telecoms remains the top sector. 38% of the fast growth track companies are in technology and telecoms. And this has been the case since the inception of the report. And we can't see this changing from in future years. What we do see changing is that the type of technology businesses are changing from the traditional IT service provision to perhaps give more digitally based IT businesses. The second next biggest sector is the pharmaceuticals and chemical sector, alluded to by all speakers. And I'm particularly pleased that they have regained their second place on the list. And as has been mentioned, the Indian pharmaceutical industry is one of the biggest in the world, and they've been particularly supportive of the UK government and UK country in terms of supply of drugs in this current crisis. Engineering manufacturing, which was again mentioned by CB, remains still a dominant sector at 14%. And we do see that Indian economic contribution in engineering and manufacturing will continue going forward. The remaining sectors are business services, energy, and hospitality. In terms of location-wise, London still dominates the investment destination for Indian-owned companies, with just over half of the Indian businesses being based in London. And that's particularly pertinent in the sense that of the 52 Indian inward projects into the United Kingdom last year, 32 were in London alone. At this point, I'd just like to highlight that the United Kingdom was the top destination for Indian companies last year, followed by the US and the UAE. What's another interesting thing I'd just like to highlight here is that North has increased its penetration from 11% to 14%, and perhaps this is a reflection of the UK's efforts to create the Northern powerhouse. I think that gives you hopefully a good flavor of this year's research and findings. As I say, it's encouraging to note that Indian companies have remained robust in terms of their economic contribution to the UK. And I particularly think that as we recover from the current COVID-19 pandemic, we will see Indian companies playing a very integral part in the recovery phase. At this point, I'd now like to hand over to Chandru Iyer, who is head of our Business Development and South Asia Group, to take on the rest of the webinar. Chandru, over to you.
Thank you, Anuj. For that. So we are going to look at the second part of today's webinar, where we have just launched the India Meets Britain Track Report. And what we're going to look at is whenever we launch the report every year, we also look to acknowledge the companies who have done well within key sectors and have got awards in terms of being the fastest growing companies on the list. So as Anuj mentioned, there are 72 companies on the fast growth tracker list this year. And out of those 72 companies, Anuj mentioned about a company that has grown at the rate of over 700% this year. And this company is the topper on the list, the first number on the tracker list, and also is a new entrant. So this company got the award for awards in two countries, the fastest growing company in Indian company in the UK, as well as the fastest growing new entrant. So the winner in both these categories for this year is ESL Energy Pro Assets Limited. ESL, personally, I've known this company for a while because I was instrumental in setting them up in the UK almost 4 years ago. And it's good to see this company in a very short period of time have achieved this landmark. This entity is part of ESL, which is a Ministry of Power, Government of India entity, and the joint venture, which is ESL Energy Pro, have had a lot of inorganic acquisitions in the UK over the years and have been growing at the rate of over 700%. Hearty congratulations to Team ESL. The next award is for the top employer. We also mention about the top employers from India in the UK every year in this report. And this year, like with I think previous few years, the company that is the top employer in the UK is part of a group that needs no introduction as far as India-UK business relationships concerned. This group employs more than 70,000 people in the UK, and the company within this group, which has got the award this year, is employing more than 45,000 people in the UK. So the top employer with, in the tracker list this year, the award goes to Tata Motors Limited and its various subsidiaries, including Jaguar Land Rover. We also look at awarding the fast-growing companies in the key sectors. Anuj mentioned about the three key sectors. We look at the tech and telecom sector first. This is a sector that has been on the top of the list for a few years now, and over 38% of the companies on the tracker list are from this sector. The company that has got the award this year in this category was also a new entrant last year, was number two on the list. It is number two on the list this year as well. And the award in this sector goes to Route Mobile UK Limited. Route Mobile have grown in the UK at over 200% year on year, and they are number two on the tracker list. So well done to Team Route Mobile and led by Rajdeep Gupta. The second sector, pharmaceutical and chemicals, a lot has been said about this sector by the minister and CV and Anuj. This sector has been in the news recently, and a lot of the players from the Indian pharmaceutical sector have done wonderfully well for themselves in this market in the UK. The pharmaceutical sector has grown at 15% as far as the sector is concerned, and the company that has got the award in the pharmaceutical sector this year is Torrent Pharma UK Limited. Torrent Pharma were on the list last year as a new entrant, and they have maintained their place on the tracker list this year as well. So well done to Team Torrent Pharma. The third sector that we mentioned about was the engineering and manufacturing sector. So this sector continues to be on the top of the sectoral list, and the company that has got the award in this category this year as one of the India's fastest growing company in the UK is Dhoot Transmission UK Limited. They have also had acquisitions in the UK, and this year they have grown at close to 100% year on year. So well done to team Dhoot Transmission. So that was a very quick run through the key awards that we gave out as part of the launch of the tracker report. And well done to all the companies, not just the companies which have got the award, but well done to all the 72 companies and all the 842 companies who are doing very well in the UK, having come over from India. So that's the award part of it. We quickly move on to a category segment of our launch event today, where we are looking to get some of the key investors from India and the UK to share their experience. So we call the segment Investor Speaks. And the first speaker that I'm going to invite today is from HCL Technologies. Ashish Gupta is the head of EMEA and also a corporate vice president at HCL. I'm requesting Ashish to come online. Ashish, and please do share your HCL UK's journey, as well as the steps that you're taking currently in the current pandemic situation that we are all facing, and what steps HCL is taking. Over to you, Ashish. Thank you.
Okay. Chandru, you can hear me loud and clear?
Yes, yes, yes. Thanks, Ashish.
So let me start by first thanking Lord Grimstone, Mrs. Ruchi Ghanshyam, Mr. Banerjee, and Anuj, you and Chandru for inviting me to sort of speak about, I'll really speak about two things. For the last 20 years, HCL's been investing quite heavily in the European market, and UK continues to be our prime destination where the investment has sort of come in, right? We've been very lucky that these investments have really paid off. They've really made us, I would say, one of the fastest growing Indian service providers in the European market, right? Roughly about a 70% CAGR over the last 20 years is really what we have sort of done, right? Which I think is just absolutely sort of stupendous, right? Now, when we start looking at post March 15th, which is really when the world suddenly realized that COVID was here, and it was something which was really going to start, impacting everybody. And it's a crisis which is not just a healthcare crisis; it's really transforming itself into a social and economic crisis. It's obviously a difficult time to plan. So the good news for us was that when the first human-to-human transmission started happening around the January 25th sort of a time frame, January 26th is when HCL sort of kicked off its BCP, right? Now, just to give you a context, HCL is really at the heart of the technology, which runs a lot of critical things for the world at large, right? In the UK, we run a large number of utilities, right? In the UK, we run a large number of grocery retail organizations and so on and so forth. The technology of that is something which is underpinned by HCL. So it was absolutely essential for us to be early to the party in terms of preparation of, if this were to go bad, right, what do we do? So I think we did very, very well in being very early and sort of kicking off our BCP plans, which really meant that as the world sort of started entering into a lockdown, we were quite ready for continuing to support all our customers across the UK, across the globe, across EMEA, right? And I think we've sort of come out of that first phase of the COVID impact relatively sound, actually, with a lot of kudos from a lot of customers and a lot of, people who sort of work with us closely. Moving forward, the way I look at it is we are actually quite lucky to be in technology, right? Because technology is the transformation which technology was already driving in the world economy is only going to be accelerated by COVID-19, right? All of us have suddenly now realized that all of us can be a million times more proactive, and we can actually work on a setting such as this. We can do a lot of webinars, we can do a lot of training, a lot of those sort of things are starting to happen. Give it time and it will only just creep into the way all of us work. So the first thing is great that we are in technology. The short term is anybody's guess. It could be the next 6 months, it could be maybe 9 months, right? The short term, I think, is going to be a bit painful, right? That is to be expected, but we are not really worried about the short term, because for us, we've been in the UK for a very long period of time, and we continue to be, you know, dominating our respective segments and gaining market share. So we are here for the long term, and we really see that in the midterm to the long term, given how we are structured today, we are really going to gain out of, you know, being a more closer partner to a lot of our customers. So when we are going into the next 6 months, 9 months, there are essentially just three principles on which we are working. And I suppose a lot of, you know, companies would be dealing with it in quite similar manners. The first and foremost is we are known as an employee first company, right? What that really means is that we really put people at the heart of our business. And that continues to be our first and most important response, right? We've said very clearly that there will be no COVID-related redundancies anywhere in the globe, including in the UK, right? And that's really, I think, the first thing which we as an organization are sort of, you know, making sure that our sort of employees and our customers and all the stakeholders sort of understand. The second is that, you know, a lot of our customers really are in trouble, right? And a good partnership is actually only tested when you get into trouble, right? And that has been a very core philosophy. So relationship beyond the contract really just means that we are a partner you can depend on, right? And the second principle, therefore, with which you're working is you're working very closely with our customers to support them during this time of distress, right? Whatever way we can, right? And those are things which we are working with them on a very active sort of basis. The third, and maybe, you know, I said we in technology are lucky, right? So we cannot be ignorant of the fact that there is, you know, just mayhem happening outside our very doors, right? The social impact of this is just going to be significant and immense, right? So in HCM, we've had a philosophy which we call as the power of one, right? Each one of us can make a difference. Each one of us can actually make a massive, you know, contribution. And we really just do a very simple thing, which is say, okay, each one of us, you know, depending on your sort of generosity, decide what you would attempt to do, and HCL is going to match that, you know, 1:1. So in the UK, we actually launched a campaign. We work very closely with the Prince's Trust, right? We work with them in terms of, you know, Get Started with Technology, which is a platform which we've created to sort of teach marginalized youth technology. Now, what we've really done is we've really started, you know, the process of making sure that all the employees across the UK and across EMEA can actually contribute to this particular initiative, and HCL is matching it 1:1. And we're going to funnel all of that back into the Prince's Trust to start making sure that we can make the impact where we think the impact is going to be the best. So those are our three priorities, right? Along the way, if we come across anything which is a good opportunity for us to continue to become more relevant to the market, we'll be very open for investments and things of that sort. So with that, I think, Chandru, I'll hand it over back to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ashish. That was really, really heartening to hear from you. Of course, your UK journey, HCL's UK journey, but also the fact that in the current situation that we are all facing, the kind of steps that you are taking as an organization to be people-friendly, to be client-friendly, and also do your bit for the society. I think that's phenomenal. Thank you very much, Ashish, for that. Really appreciate that. I'm going to now request my other speaker. So HCL has been in the UK for a very long time, but my next speaker represents an organization which is a relatively new entrant in this market. But in a very short period of time, they have made a name for themselves in this country. Can I invite Rishabh Gupta to share the experiences of OYO in this market, OYO's UK journey, and also the kind of steps that OYO is taking in the current pandemic situation, being from the travel and leisure sector. Rishabh, thank you very much for sparing your time today, and over to you. Thanks.
Thank you, Chandru. Thank you, High Commission, for inviting me to this webinar. Our story is a little bit interesting, given that we come from the hospitality industry. But before I kickstart and share more, let me first give you a quick background about OYO and its journey in the UK. We are one of the world's leading hospitality companies that was founded back in 2013 by a young entrepreneur called Ritesh Agarwal. We partner with independently owned hotels and inject capabilities of revenue management, technology, and brand. After operating for 4 years in India, we soon expanded into other markets in Asia, including China, Malaysia, Indonesia, Nepal. We entered the UK in October 2018, and it was the first market, a Western market outside of Asia for OYO. And we committed roughly £40 million as an investment to the market. We started 2019 with 4 hotels in London, and we ended the year with over 200 plus hotels across 100 plus cities, which are spread over the entire UK territories, England, Wales, Ireland, and Scotland. 2020, when we started, we redefined our new goals. We decided to go and build our business more profitably with very high focus on customer and partner experience. But when we were building the plan, I don't think so anyone had anticipated the impact COVID-19 would have on our business. As a hospitality player, we are in the eye of the storm. This is not the first major disruption to the travel industry that we are enduring, but COVID-19 has and will hit us much harder than all the other disruptions put together. Occupancy throughout the UK is almost fallen by 80%, and there are still no clear signs of recovery as we nearly enter, you know, the end of 6 weeks of lockdown, with I think another few weeks to more for at least everyone, and for the hospitality industry, many months. But now let me explain you what we have been doing, and as an organization here in the UK, one has been preparing for the short term. How do we survive and make sure we navigate this challenge in the short term, and what do we do for the long term? In the short term, we got a little bit of heads up given our China presence. We understood how the COVID spread and what impact it would have on our company industry. So there was a little bit of preparedness that we were able to manage. We started before the lockdown was announced. We were already gearing up to operate the business remotely. And for a hospitality company, I can assure you that it's a very difficult job. So that every employee would be working from home, but our operations would still continue to run. Second was about the partners. We introduced flexible booking policies where people could get a full refund till the day of the travel, which was not very usual for the market like the UK, which is mainly run on non-refundables. I think, unfortunately, our distribution partners like booking.com, Expedia, they called in for force majeure and allowed customers to refund their non-refundable bookings as well. Now, obviously, as an industry, we are here to serve our customers. So I think we supported that idea. But I can tell you the adverse impact on the business was millions of dollars of business for the next 5-6 months got wiped out completely for us and our partners. Last is that, you know, we needed to check whether our owners are open, whether they will be operational, because most of these hotels that we run are owner managed and operated. So that was when March ended. So as we started our journey in April, which is when the lockdown, that was the first week of lockdown, or second week of lockdown, it became quite clear that the key workers would need accommodation. And we were getting a lot of requests from people in distress, travelers who were stranded, students who were stranded. And we felt we needed to play our part. So we worked very quickly with our partners to open up almost 2,000 rooms in our portfolio. Rates were set with not a profitability mindset in place. Rather, they were set with a mindset of how we can offer these rooms at as low a price, just covering the operational costs for the businesses on the ground. And these are all small businesses, so they're very important for their community, and they also want to survive through this pandemic. Further, our usual distribution partners weren't working out. Booking.com had closed, which is the largest channel for us as a hotel company. They closed down their doors. So we repurposed our entire team to act as distribution partners, like agents. So everyone reached out to consuls, NHS, hospitals, to create and see if there is any kind of demand required. Over 4 weeks of work in April, we managed to create 35,000 bookings. Today, over 1,000 people in distress stay at our hotels every night. With this, you know, OYO has been able to generate enough occupancy for the partners that are keen to remain open. Our current trending occupancy is roughly around 35%, which is almost twice the market average. So this has allowed the owners to stay operational and cover their operational cost. We are further looking to make 1,000 rooms more available for the people in distress. But this is just the beginning of the end. Now, planning for longer term has become more important. And I think there are so many open questions that we face as a company and the industry faces. There are, I think, a lot of issues around leases, restaurants, hotels. Our partners would be entered into lease contracts, and the lease numbers would be more applicable to the 2019 revenue figures than what the 2020 revenue figures would show up as. Second is our employees. I think, you know, I really appreciate the support that the government has been able to offer companies like us, allowing us to put people on a job retention scheme. But at least we need to acknowledge that, you know, when we come out of this COVID, the government is going to wind down that support, but the revenues are not going to pick up at that level. So how do we ensure maximum employability of our people as we come out of this journey? So we are, you know, trying our level best. We are probably using different tactics to allow for employment to continue. But I can tell you that now, as a company, after having to really figure out the short term, now we have started looking at the long term in terms of creating demand. There are some green shoots. London is picking up on occupancy back again. So there are some green shoots, but it's still a long way to go for a company like us in the hospitality industry. Thank you, Chandru.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Rishabh. I think it's been a baptism by fire for you at OYO in a very short period of time. You've seen a lot, I think, in this market. But that's just the times that we're all going through. And it's really, really good to see that some of the steps that you took to, especially to take care of the interests of the people on the front line, NHS and others who are doing a fantastic job of keeping UK safe and healthy. So thanks for sharing those insights. Really appreciate that. I'm going to request you to stay online and see if, I think we've got the time for some few questions. We're just going over 12 noon, but I think just maybe a couple of questions. So if I can request Ashish to come back online as well, if Ashish is still with us, and maybe Anuj, do you want to join, Anuj? If you're still there, just a few quick questions. Thank you, Anuj. Thank you, Ash. Rishabh, I can see that, so I'm probably going to ask you a quick question. As a new entrant, I'm sure you would have had some learnings along your way as far as setting up in the UK is concerned. So there would be a lot of Indian companies who are looking to set up in the UK and set a foothold in this market. So any do's and don'ts for them?
I think the first key learning for us has been, how do you build a balanced team, a team that creates the right culture, the company culture in a new market, and a team that can allow you to adapt closely to the market nuances. I think given we've expanded all over the world and we've gotten a new learning in every market. In the UK, I think there is a very open culture It's not like China, where you know building businesses and teams are difficult. There is a very big openness, especially in London, where the diversity is absolutely acknowledged, right? So I think for organizations who are confused about what type of teams to build here in the UK, my honest admission would be that don't worry too much. I think there is a lot of respect for Indians. There is a lot of respect for Indian leaders. The only highlight I would mention here is that the Indian leaders need to have the cultural openness to adapt if you are leading an organization here. So your entire team who's being brought from India to build that company values, they need to have the cultural openness to allow people to build a new way forward.
Thank you, Rishabh. That's pearls of wisdom coming from you for companies who are looking to set their footprints in this market. I can see on the chat box here that we're having loads of questions coming through. Unfortunately, we are coming very close to the end of this session. Just one quick question, Anuj, that I'm seeing here is that somebody has asked that you've been involved with the tracker report for the last 7 years. So very quickly, what are the trends that you're seeing in terms of what are the changing face of Indian investments in the UK? Some quick thoughts from you.
Thank you, Chandru. As I mentioned at the beginning, this is the seventh edition of the report. And I think I'd perhaps like to highlight three things that have sort of in terms of trends is the question you ask. Number one is the number of Indian companies in the UK has increased significantly. I recall that back in 2014, when we did the first report, we had around 650 companies, and today we have 842. So there's been a dramatic increase in the number. I think sector-wise, as I said earlier in my talk, the technology and telecom still remains the top sector, and pharmaceuticals has always been the second biggest sector, and I can't see that changing for the next few years. In terms of region-wise, it's interesting to note that even early on, London was dominant, but not as dominant. In fact, I think the dominance of London has increased to some extent, but it's very encouraging to see that regions like the North are taking increasing market share of the Indian investment into the UK. So I think, just conscious of time, I mean, I could go on for long, but those would be the sort of key trends coming out of the over the last 7 years in terms of publishing this report.
Thank you, Anuj. That was quite useful as well. So I hope that question got answered by one of the attendees who had asked it. Thank you very much for that, Anuj. I'm just wary of the time, so I think we would like to bring this session to a close now. Thank you all for joining us for the launch of the web launch, should I say, of the Grant Thornton CII India Meets Britain Tracker Report 2020 edition. The report will be available to be downloaded from our website immediately after the webinar ends, and you'll also be getting a link to download this report on an email immediately after this webinar. So thank you very much for joining us. A quick two lines for those who can stay with us after this session. There is a quick survey that will pop up when you close this webinar. Please do feel free to share your thoughts about what you think about the current situation and moving beyond COVID-19. What are the kind of steps that you are looking to take as an organization? And these insights will be helpful for us to plan for the future as well for all of you. So thank you once again for joining us for the launch of the 2020 Tracker Report. I hope you found this session useful, and please do download the report and make good use of it. Thank you, stay well, and stay healthy. Thank you.